Success. I'm your host Raju Mandhiya. Here at Expat Insights, we take external views of the internal successes by foreigners, expats, and immigrants who have made Philippines their home. Tonight on Expat Insights, we have two guests, and they really cannot be called expats because I am much more of an expat than they are. One of them is from India, and he runs an NGO in this country. It's not really an NGO, but an institute that facilitates and supports other NGOs. His name is Srinivas Narayanan, for short Srini, the founder and the managing director of Assist Asia. So, and the second guest, we'll introduce her later one more time. Her name is Julie Marvin, the founding director of Philippine Institute for the Deaf. So we'll get her after the first break. Srini, welcome to Expat Insights.
Thank you, Raju.
And we are going to talk about process-oriented progress, and of course we get to know you first.
Yes, indeed. Thank you very much for having me here.
Yeah.
It is a pleasure to be here. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So tell us a bit about yourself, Srini, your venture into the Philippines and how much you like Philippines and
yes.
How.
Oh, yes. Yeah. It's been a long story. I am originally from India, from mm-hmm. the southern part of India. I came here 16 years ago, quite some time ago.
Yeah.
I came here to study, actually.
Yeah.
I did my master's in business management
mm-hmm.
at the Asian Institute of Management, and I decided to stay back. Yeah, so I built my business career and family in the Philippines over the last 16 years. So this is home for me. Yeah,
16 years, and President Ramos was the president that time.
Exactly.
So tell me, what was more fun in the Philippines that time, and that made you stay here?
There were a lot of opportunities. I don't need to reiterate the loving nature of the Filipino people.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and even though it was the height of the ASEAN crisis, the Asian crisis, in fact, Philippines was one of the countries which was not majorly affected by that.
Quite.
Yeah, when I came out of school, Singapore, Thailand, Indonesia were all in doldrums. Philippines was doing reasonably well. And I decided to stay back. So opportunities were there. For many people who are so used to Fort Bonifacio today, it was not there at all.
Exists,
so you could imagine the amount of progress that has happened from that perspective alone in the last 15 years. So I believe for me and for our organization, it was the right decision to stay here.
And you're happy here today?
Certainly I am.
Yeah. Srini, appreciate the country you come from.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of love it. No, I have a little bias towards it. No,
so
leaving aside the discussion of that country, let's talk about what you do. And you're doing something really important, and that creates a major impact not just in the Philippines but across Asia and maybe the world. No, you are assisting nonprofits and NGOs in who are into developmental work. So give us a picture of what Assist is and what Assist does.
Okay. Yes, indeed. Assist itself is a non-profit. We focus on two major areas, which is one is to improve social conditions of people,
mm-hmm.
And the other is to be able to do that in a very environmentally and socially responsible manner. So social improvement and sustainable transformation is the way we do things. And yes, while we are an NGO ourselves, we believe in a simple philosophy called partner to progress. So our entire organization is revolving around the letter P. We are peace lovers.
Mm-hmm.
So it's people and the planet, and the other two P's are partner to progress, actually.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So we feel that there are many, many, many institutions. In this particular case, I'm speaking about NGOs, but I would say in the same breath, government agencies, corporations, who all have a lot of good that they want to do,
mm-hmm.
but they would probably be able to do it in a much better manner
mm-hmm.
and probably faster manner
mm-hmm.
if they are able to partner. Yeah?
Yeah.
So we facilitate these partnerships so that we can achieve social progress.
Okay.
Yeah?
Before we explore the benefits of the partnering,
mm-hmm. no?
And you said there are scores of these institutions. Some
mm-hmm.
of them are well-formed, well-structured, while some are not-for-profit, some are doing actual hands-on work. No?
Mm-hmm.
What are they doing currently, and what is the gap that can be filled in terms of improving their performance, improving their delivery? What is that gap? So where are they today, and what is the gap?
Okay, according to Wikipedia and several other sources, from what I understand, and there are close to 250,000 NGOs / civil society organizations / non-profits.
Cite an example quickly, something that my audience across the provinces might be well conversant with.
Well, it could be from trade unions, it could be from chambers of commerce, it could be from organizations which are very popular like Greenpeace and WWF and Gavad Kalinga,
Melotos,
for example.
Yeah, Tony Melotos, yeah.
Exactly. So you have several types of organizations in this 250,000 I'm speaking about. Mm-hmm. The 250,000 I mentioned are primarily Filipino organizations, NGOs who are registered here. And they all, I believe, certainly have very great and very good intentions to do a lot of good things.
Right. You
know, each one might have a different cause.
Yeah.
Some might work on the environment, some might work on the oceans, some might work on children.
Yeah.
And you can imagine, we are certainly a country which probably can do with all this good work.
We all need it.
Yes.
We all need it, yeah.
Yeah, and one always wonders, if there are so many people actually working on it, how come we do not achieve scale?
Good point.
Yeah,
really good point.
I believe that most of them, while they are very passionate, they have a clear purpose, somehow are not able to scale up. Yeah, somehow are not able to go beyond the small community that they work. And if they are indeed doing a great work, and I'm sure the few people they impact are really benefited.
I'm sure they do,
And it is great work. So I'm not saying that it is always important to scale up, but if there is a good model and it works, I believe others could also benefit from that.
So thus, let me try to understand it. So if there is an institution and it's helping the deaf,
right,
like my next guest, and they've been doing it for the last 25 years, and so have the passion, they have the initiative, and they have the talent too.
Mm-hmm.
But yet somehow they have not been able to expand their services or systemize their activities or become self-sustainable in such a way.
Mm-hmm.
So you come in.
Yes.
Would that be the right place for you to come in?
Yes. You could certainly say that at least part of our work revolves around such activities. ASIS itself has its own social mission.
Yeah.
So we do activities which are completely driven by our own strategies. For example, so we have an initiative for school children. We are right now working on an initiative to launch a magazine and portal for NGOs called the Asian NGO.
Yeah.
And apart from that, we have around 40 projects across various countries, which is to do with various initiatives like energy efficiency, environmental improvement, social standards in the industry, increasing the competitiveness of companies by getting them certified, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, for example, if there are small and medium enterprises in the food industry, we have certain projects here in the Philippines, Vietnam and Cambodia, which are training these companies to...
There are NGOs in the food industry?
No, these are not necessarily NGOs.
Oh, these are
private companies.
For-profit.
For-profit companies.
Yeah.
And we help them through capacity building.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So our outreach is not necessarily for NGOs.
Mm.
It is also for SMEs, actually.
And yet ASIS by itself is totally not-for-profit.
Not-for-profit, yes. You're right.
So can you share us a best practice, a success story of an NGO rather than a for-profit institution?
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
We have run, in fact, one of them is actually continues to run as a project on women's rights, actually. Yeah.
In the Philippines. Right.
I'm specifically speaking about the Philippines. Now, here is a great institution which is very passionate, very competent, very qualified, and has been doing a lot of good work as it is.
Mm-hmm.
But now, getting access to finance is always a challenge, whether you're an NGO, whether you're a private company, and this is where we came in this particular project.
For women's rights. So would you want to name the institute? Or
I wouldn't mind. They are, mm-hmm. In one case, they are the Women Crisis Center. They are associated with the East Avenue Medical Center.
Okay.
Another one called Women Lead. Yeah.
I don't
know. That is exactly the point. There are several such organizations would do mm-hmm. a lot of good work, and not many of them are familiar with that. And this is where we come in. We sit down with them, identify a common purpose that we could work together, common goal that we could work together, and then look for potential sources of funds to sort of fund the project, if that is what is required. Mm-hmm. In some cases, expertise is required. In that case, we are looking for technical experts.
Right.
Yeah.
Or
so
psychotherapists or
precisely
specialists.
Yeah. Anybody who has the competence. For example, with the Philippine Institute of for the Deaf, there are several things one could imagine doing.
Yeah.
You know. So to either improve their facilities or to improve their marketing, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And there are several institutions which offer these services or funds, actually. So in many ways, I would like to think of us as somebody who brings these two groups together, actually. Yeah.
So that's assist. That's assist.
Yes, in that sense, we do assist.
Yeah.
But like I said, we do have our own activities that we do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Where we directly apply for grants and then implement these projects. But on the other hand, we also help out and partner.
Well, what comes to my mind is that if I was East Avenue Medical Center helping women in trouble, and I was director or the board of directors, and you come in and make me an offer, what would come up in my mind is a question of trust. Do I trust this person?
Mm-hmm.
My intentions are good, but what are the intentions
certainly,
of this
certainly.
Outsider? Plus, not only that, I think you have to get trust from your funding source too. So you're juggling two balls. So how does that, how do you mitigate that? How do you manage that?
Well, there are two ways to go about it. In traditional fundraising, there are processes,
That's like a business. Fundraising is
no,
like...
No, there are grant makers. I'm speaking specifically about the non-profit industry.
Yeah.
And there are specifically grant makers, Let us say the European Commission, for example. Or, for example, there are several institutions in Germany or USAID.
Mm-hmm.
They come out with a call for a proposal and they clearly indicate who can be the applicant, what should be the criteria or the qualification of the applicant.
Yeah.
And typically, you follow these guidelines.
Correct.
So, and track record always helps.
Right.
And in some cases, well, actually in most cases, I think the initial trust and the meeting of minds is very important in any partnership.
Right.
Yeah. And once that has been established, you follow the process.
Does you come in as a very special service?
Mm-hmm.
That means not only do you understand the funder's mind, but you also understand the NGO, the developmental group's mind too.
Sure.
And you create the blend. So you're kind of a matchmaker.
You could call us that. That is what we would like to slowly transform and become. Yeah.
Just the matchmaker.
Not just the matchmaker. Right now, we are also a small NGO and we go after grants and we implement it ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Then we realized over the last 10 years, and we are 10 years old next year, that we have indeed built this capability, which now I believe we can actually share with others. Yeah.
Mm.
We don't need to get paid for this. We would like to just be part of the social cause, actually.
Mm.
And that is how we would like to move forward in the future.
That's your dream. Yeah.
That's certainly my dream. And as an organization, we are growing bigger. We have assist in Vietnam, which takes care of the Mekong region. We have assist in India right now, which takes care of South Asia. But the headquarters is firmly rooted in the Philippines. And we do projects in the Philippines, in Indonesia, in China, all managed out of here. And so I think we have built a very good team. We have set up good processes.
Yeah.
And I believe it is time that we start helping other NGOs who are our partners and friends, and I think they can benefit from that, and we can learn in the process as well. Yeah.
Before I go into asking you on how should other NGOs approach you, and if there's any criterial needs that they should offer, what is the story of East Avenue Medical Center today? Are you still holding hands with them, or you have let them fly on their own?
So this is
just to close up that story.
Sure. I need to clarify here. It's not the East Avenue Medical Center itself, but it's a
unit
center.
Inside.
Yeah, it's okay. A unit inside. It's called the Women Crisis Center. This was for a particular project which was focused on promoting the Republican Act 9262, which is on women and abused women, abused women, or children, women survivors. Yes, the project has come to a close. It was funded by the European Commission, but a lot of collaterals, a web portal was developed where victims can actually approach and ask for legal support or advice, and WCC provides that. But because of the good work, I believe, that was done as part of the project, yet another project was launched. It was called Justice and Healing. WCC is a part of it.
WCC is
the Women Crisis Center.
Yeah.
It's also a part of that particular project, and we certainly intend to work together as we move along. Yeah, that is just one example. There are several other projects and several other institutions, and yes, because some of these are projects, it does come to a logical conclusion. But the relationship and the friendship always sustains and continues. Yeah.
So my insight into this is that most of them are kind of unorganized, they stumble through it, and you're providing a certain process and a framework. So how would you define that? What are your steps into driving their projects into success or holding their hands into success? What are the 3 or 5 step methods that you do, and that is different compared to what Tony Melotto's group is doing, or PID?
I would not talk about any other groups per se, but
I
specifically talk about what we are doing. Like I mentioned, small or big, anything good is always welcome. And I think most of the organizations that we are speaking about do good things within the limited scope of whatever they have. Now, if this is something we also believe in, then we would approach these guys, or in many cases they approach us and say, you know what, this is what we are doing, and we would like to do something more on this. This could be on migration, it could be on overseas Filipinos, for example, and their rights, or it could be on a particular industry association and saying that, you know what, we would like to do organic farming for our or train our people on food safety, for example. Now, the moment we have such a discussion, then we do one of two possible things, actually. One is to look for potential grants or grants available out there, which sort of meets these requirements. So which means basically we have a small team which sort of goes through and tries to understand what are all the grants that are available on a regular basis. I mean, it is very, very regular in that sense. Almost every week we are monitoring more than 500 different sources of information to look at various grants. Now, we can't obviously work on everything.
This must be costly too.
It is costly, but I believe that it ultimately serves a purpose, and that is what we are trying to reach out. Now, what we would like to do, and that is exactly what I mentioned earlier, is that all this work, we are trying to now put it into a magazine and a portal. And for less than $20 a year, something around that figure, we would like to make this information available to all the NGOs,
the
not only in the Philippines.
The learning,
the learning, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So and then we would apply for these grants.
Srini, I'm going to ask you the question about the magazine and how to subscribe to it. No, let me ask you a personal question.
Sure.
What got you going into this, and what does it fulfill inside of you today? What got you going? Where did you start and say, I want to do this?
Okay, actually, well, I think the roots for this go very deep and very long time ago. My mother was a school teacher and a social worker.
No kidding.
Yes.
And this is in Madras.
This is in Chennai, in the south of India. socially conscious person.
Woman.
Yes, woman.
She's still around?
No, I lost her when I was quite young. This was about close to 30 years ago. But it left a lot of impact on me. So there were two things I wanted to do. One was always to be somewhere connected to the field of teaching.
Right.
And the second thing is, if I could do this thing related to teaching on something which is socially responsible and socially relevant.
Yeah.
So right out of AIM, I started an environmental consulting company.
So socially
and environmentally responsible, but at the same time consulting meant technical assistance, teaching.
High impact, really high impact.
So I was going around in Laguna, Cavite, Subic, teaching companies how to become more
productive,
environmentally better managed and things like that. And while that was a private company, it still exists. I'm not directly involved in it, but it is quite successful. I slowly stumbled upon the fact that using the same skill sets of training, capacity building, technical assistance, and working on causes like social responsibility, environmental management, there is a whole
New world out there.
Out there, exactly.
So kudos to your efforts, Srini.
Thank you, sir.
You're doing a wonderful job, and you make me proud to be an expat and an Indian. So good luck with all you do.
Thank you very much.
And I just want you to now plug your magazine and also the website and the contact details of Assist. Two things. And if there's anyone you want to thank for your success or support, this is your time. And but first, go ahead and plug the magazine and other business, the training business.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, as I mentioned right in the beginning, Assist follows a philosophy called Partner to Progress. I would reach out to all of you out there who wants to consider any form of partnership, but or just for that matter, a coffee. Please feel free to contact us. You could contact us through www.assistasia.org.
Yeah.
The magazine is about 6 months away. It's called AsianNGO.org. Okay, so. Even though the magazine is still yet to be released, AsianNGO.org, if you visit that, you would be able to see a little bit of information about what is to come, and you can register yourself there, and we will contact you the moment the magazine is released. So feel free. The worst that can happen is you would enjoy a great cup of coffee, so it can't be that worse, actually. So please feel free to come and contact us, and we are looking forward to partnering with you. I'd like to thank Raju for giving this opportunity. I think.
You don't have to, Srini. It's okay.
It is
understood.
Yeah. Great. Yeah.
So I thank you very much for being on the show, and good luck in all you do. And I'd like you to stay and listen to the lady who's come up here, and she's done some amazing work in the last 25 years for the hearing impaired. She calls them the deaf, but I'm not sure if I should call them. So stay with us and watch this show. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
God bless. Yeah?
Yeah. Bye-bye.
So stay watching. We are on Expat Insights, and I just finished talking to Srini Narayanan from Assist.org. And now we'll talk to Julie Marvin right after the break.